back here on First Things First. Undisputed is coming up at 9:30 sharp. Joy, hope you had a great weekend. What are you and the guys talking about today?
Good morning, Jenna. Good morning, guys. Hope you had a great weekend. Also, coming up on Undisputed, do the Cavs have any chance of winning this series? And did Steve Kerr take a shot at LeBron last night? Plus, Steven Jackson and Chris Broussard are in studio with us. Undisputed is coming up next. Jenna, back to you guys.
All right, Joy, thank you. We look forward to that. It's now time for Say What? Draymond Green did his best LeBron impression wearing shorts with his suit ahead of Game 2 last night. After the game, he was asked if he wore shorts to psych out LeBron and the Cavs. Say what?
You're not really psyching nobody out. They get a little warm in this room, so these shorts, you know, bode well for me. Then it's a little linen, so it ain't too hot up here right now. But, yeah, I think it's a cool look.
See, listen, we've gone round and round about this today. See, you endorse this look. You endorse the shorts with the suit.
Well, this is what I do know. When you're an athlete, fashion is not what you see in the magazine. Fashion is what you wear.
Well, that's what I've been telling you about Russ. And you've been killing Russ for his fashion.
Russ looks like a fool, man. No. One day he's with the safety patrol helping kids cross the street. Like, someday he looked like,
What are they doing? What are they doing with this picture?
Oh, yeah, I told him not to do this too, Nick. I told him that doesn't make
any
sense.
They literally photoshopped Chris into a suit I own, down to and including the lapel pin. But they make Chris look cool.
Yeah, because I'm not. I knew that. I knew that wasn't Christine picking my clothes.
You don't do the flower lapel pin stuff. I do that. I like that. So, CeCe, and they got him buttoned in his jacket, little cool eyes closed look. Me, they look like
they tried to find. They tried to find a cool look from you.
Uh huh.
And they, since you were born, no shot.
Oh, wow. Wow. Shots fired.
We called your sister.
And what's up with my legs, man? What?
Now, that wasn't even right. You guys own some old Chuck Taylors, too, like.
That whole thing.
But you and your wife, y'all love them colors and them
Briscoes.
I
do like those colors.
Boy, y'all
well, I'm one third of the best dressed show on morning television, right? That's what you call us? Correct?
Yeah, but.
Oh, okay, hold on. Careful treading here.
Okay, there was an article in GQ magazine when I was in the league, best dressed in the NFL. Mm-hmm. Myself, Deion Sanders, were first and second place.
Mm-hmm. Just saying.
No.
That's great.
I'm just saying.
I don't know what that has to do with what we're talking about right now. I'm very proud.
Yeah, I've been dressing for a long time. Really, really nice. I'm glad to have you guys on the show.
Oh, shots fired all around by one Chris Carter.
Can you guys take your shoes off?
Okay.
Because I'm a carry.
Shots, uh-huh.
Got it. I see what's happening here. More from Game 2. The Cavs find themselves down 2-0 despite having the best player in basketball, LeBron James, followed up his 51-point performance in Game 1 with 29 and 13 assists in Game 2. His teammates shot just 39% from the floor. That's neither good nor is it really surprising. Here's what LeBron had to say after the game.
Well, I think at the end of the day, we have a Game 3 to play. And, you know, we got an opportunity to go home, and we played, you know, some really good basketball on our home floor, but, you know, that shouldn't give us any comfort. We should still be uncomfortable with the series as we were in Game 1 and as we were tonight.
CeCe, did it look like the Cavs took what happened in Game 1 with them into Game 2, that it was sort of looming over them a little bit as they entered the game?
Now, it's really hard to see an effect on a play like that on the rest of the team. And just trying to analyze the first 12 minutes, the person involved, JR, and before the game even started, I thought that they did something major. That was JR. He addressed it, said he didn't know what the score was at that time, kind of changed his statement. I believe that's very, very important because there's a certain level of accountability, regardless of what you answer to the media and people outside the room. Inside, we need to know that you didn't know that. And I believe that was important. He got beyond that by admitting that he made a mistake right there and also said he was glad it happened to him compared to one of his teammates in the first 12 minutes. Unless blowing an opportunity to steal a game number one, unless it affects your defense, then I would say, yeah, it really affected them because their defense in the first quarter was awful. Their inability to recognize what they were doing as far as slipping the screens, the Warriors getting to the rim, finishing with dunks and layups. If that's it, then yes. But the rest of it, no. JR scored more points in the first quarter than he scored the rest of the game.
Scored his only point.
So I would say no. No, it didn't have an effect going forward. This is a veteran team. They realized they lost an opportunity. But ultimately, even if it didn't affect them, they know, the Cavs know, Man, we gave away a tremendous opportunity.
Listen, who are the people most involved in what happened at the end of game one? JR, right? So he was terrible yesterday. But he's been terrible basically the entirety of the playoffs. And the only shots he made, the worst season as a pro. The only shots he made were in the first quarter. Who else was involved? George Hill, right? Because he misses the free throw. George Hill was their third best player last night. Mm-hmm. You want to go even further? Who else was involved? Well, Kevin Love did foul Steph on the previous play that allowed the Warriors to take the lead. Mm-hmm. Kevin Love was good yesterday. Started off poorly, 2 of 10, but he finished with 22 and 10 on nearly 50% shooting. Like, he was good. And then
LeBron
was outstanding, man. Like, we have now just started to take this guy for granted. This is insane. Since LeBron came into the league, so last night LeBron accounted for 60 points via scoring and assists. Since LeBron came into the league, a guy accounting for at least 60 points in a finals game has happened 13 times. LeBron's done it 12 of them, and wow. Steph in game two of last year's NBA Finals did it. So the last 15 years happened 12 times, 13 times. LeBron's done 12 of them. One of them was last night. Another one, of course, was game one. So, like, LeBron was fine. It was everybody else. Jeff Green, 5 of 4. In the first two games, Jeff Green, 5 of 14. Last night, Jeff Green gives you 2 of 7. Kyle Korver, unplayably bad. Jordan Clarkson continues to be one of the worst rotation players I've ever seen in NBA Finals. And I saw Sasha Vujacic in the rotation of an NBA Finals. Like, you can't have these guys play that poorly in a game where Steph, Clay, and KD are going to combine for what? Oh, they combined for 79 points. Like, you just, there's not paths to victory when those things happen. Even though the Cavs, they didn't get blown out till the very end, I never felt like they were in the game.
Are there things the Cavs can do that are fixable? Can you say, okay, you got to come out and you got to play more with more intensity. You got to play better defense, at least right off the start. You got to be able to, like, get in it more. Like some of the things Scalabrini was talking about, when you're in the paint, shoot.
Every playoff series, the physicality becomes very important. The sense of urgency becomes important after that. The Cavs know in this, they can't afford to lose this game. So I expect them to play better defense. Role players, they get more energy playing at home. They play better at home. But you can look at the three-point line. The Cavs don't shoot the ball from the three-point line. They are going to have problems. This is an offensive team. They are not a very good defensive team. 100%. One of the bottom three defensive teams in the NBA, not for the playoffs, not for this two-game series, but over the course since when we started the season in November. All right, so that's how bad they have been. We shouldn't be shocked that we keep seeing spurts where, wow, this is the worst NBA team defensively. Well, yes, I mean, one of the worst.
Which is why what the Warriors did to open the game at the rim was so damaging. When they're slipping screens and getting shots at the rim, and now you have to worry about that, there's going to be separation on the three-point shooters, and Steph was able to take advantage in the fourth quarter. Here is what is so concerning for Cleveland. Show what LeBron James done in the NBA Finals the last 2 years against this Warriors team, the Kevin Durant Warriors team. 35 points, 11 rebounds, 10 assists, 56% shooting, and they're 1-6. 35-11-10 has gotten you one win over a seven-game sample size. LeBron is not going to play at a much higher level than he's playing. It's going to be the other guys. Now, does going home solve it for him? Are those guys better at home? The Cavs haven't lost a home playoff game since the first playoff game they played, but they also haven't played a team 60% as good as this Warriors team. Like, the reality is, the reason that it had the Cavs been playing the Rockets, I could have come on here and said, even though the Rockets are way more talented, here are the paths to victory. C's harping on the defense for a reason. You have to play 46 minutes of connected defense in order to have a shot against Golden State. The Cavs have a hard time playing 26 minutes of connected defense. It's another reason why game one was damaging. The defense was good enough to go along with the 50 ball LeBron dropped on them, and they gave that game away, or they had it taken from them, depending on how you look at it.
Right.
Like, there's no fixing that.
Well, the one thing that the Cavs can probably lean on, and is the fact that you showed the graphic, they're 1-6 in those games, even though LeBron has those tremendous numbers. We need LeBron to do exactly what he did, maybe just a little bit more. But in that 1-6 record, there was three games that the Cavs could have won. They could have won the game in series last year. Game number 3, they should have won that game. Game number 5, they could have won that game. And they should have won game number 1. So, yes, even though LeBron has been dominant, even though the reserves have been big bad, The Cavs have been right there with an opportunity. This game, game number two, was a lot like game number five last year. After three quarters, man, the Cavs, if they have a good fourth quarter, they could steal that win. So I think that there are some positive messages coming from that, even though the record against, since Durant has gotten there, has been 1-6.
You feel good about the Cavs in game three then?
Jenna, this is not a team I felt good about all year. So, no. No, it's a good question. But my answer is no. There's no way that LeBron said it. We still have to have that fear and edge that we had in game number one.
And, listen, the Warriors, the reason, if you're not going to be able to play great defense, and they're not going to, you've got to turn them over. Where I will give the Warriors a ton of credit is in these finals, after not being great with the turnovers against Houston, they have cleaned it up. Now, you might say, they had 12 turnovers yesterday. It's still a lot. As long as the Warriors are under 15, they've done a good job because they're going to be fancy with the basketball. They're going to throw one-handed passes. They're going to try to have the ooh-ah passes. The Warriors have been cautious of that. The Warriors respect their opponent in this. And what the Cavs need for Game 3 is what happened in Game 3 in 2016, that the Warriors think, oh, we've already won the finals, and they're down 31-9 late in the first quarter. Like, this Warriors team with Kevin Durant, we haven't seen them come out like that.
That's going to do it for us. We're back here tomorrow morning at 6:30. Probably talk about this game again, some other things. Undisputed starts.